Okay, so hello everybody and welcome to my presentation. Today I'd like to talk about job automation, like its benefits, its risks, and potential solutions to those risks. First, I would like to start like an economics-inspired definition of automation, which is like a functional one, saying that automation enables capital to replace labor in tasks it was previously engaged in. This means that certain physical tools, such as robots, will be able to carry out activities which were previously carried out by people. And usually people carry out these activities in exchange for wages to be able to ensure their livelihood. In order to make the change to job automation, it is important to remind ourselves that the job is usually composed of multiple activities, each with its level of difficulty and different skills required. So this hints to probably a gradual process of job automation with a possibly long transition period and not a rapid one, as maybe the internet would like us to believe. Here we can see a couple of like high emotional impact, panic-inducing titles, hinting like to imminent obsolescence of 800 million people. But besides this aspect, what is also worrying, in my opinion, is the fact that the human factor seems like to be removed from the unfolding of the events, leaving the reader the impression that there is no control over the upcoming automation wave, which is going to hit us. And this, in my opinion, is very false. And I think we can all agree that it's entirely our responsibility to make sure that any technology is applied in a proper way. And this is like the message, the overall message my talk wants to transmit. Moving over like to a more grounded approach and see what some more, let's say, professional numbers say. First, there is no clear consensus and there are several studies. The first one on the left is from Oxford and it's one of the most widely cited ones, also possibly because it's the most pessimistic of them. I'm not sure about this. And there are 47% of the jobs in the US are estimated to be automatable from a technological point of view, which is over 80 million people. Over 60% of the jobs have at least 30% of their activities automatable, claims a study from the McKinsey Institute, which translates to over 1 billion full-time equivalents worldwide, with over a half in China and India. A more conservative study from the OECD claims that there are around 14% of jobs at high risk, around 66 million, and 32% of medium risk, which is still significant in my opinion, and might mean that certain jobs, even if not fully automated away, will go through some significant changes, and the people working in these positions will need to adapt themselves to the new job market. Besides the technological feasibility of automation, there are other bottlenecks which might increase or decrease the rate of job automation. One of them is the cost of developing and deploying a research prototype and bringing it to full production environment. And the initial cost may be prohibitive, as we saw the case of surgical robots earlier. Software products, on the other hand, might be cheaper, but the overall problem here is that the big players are at a competitive advantage because usually they are the ones developing the solutions and they have more funds to invest into those and be the ones first riding the automation wave. A second one are the labor market dynamics, which basically means that if your workers have high wages, it's going to be more profitable to automate those away. And if you do not have enough workers and you need to supply a certain demand of the market, you need to automate these positions as well. And besides these quantitative factors, you also have qualitative aspects of the change, some positive and some negative. Among the positive ones, we can talk about like higher quality products, safer environment for the workers or for the people via autonomous vehicles or more climate friendly technologies. On the other hand, in some domains such as healthcare or law, the focus is not only on the performance of the algorithms. So regulation for bias and transparency And even social practices, as we've seen, can further reduce the potential for automation in these domains. More concretely, and looking at some job examples, we can see that occupations which have which are composed of fairly repetitive activities in predictable environments or processing information in standardized formats, such as like web developers or office workers or retail workers, are at a very high risk of automation. On the other hand, there are jobs which involve multiple agents cooperating or creative skills, which are currently safe. And two key observations here, which are important to remember, are the fact that educational and wage level are inversely correlated with the automation potential of these people. And these categories will need our help in order to transit the upcoming like automation wave period. Moving over to the exposure by country, we can also see some variation over here. And in absolute terms, it can turn to be quite significant. Here, it is important to take into account the demographic profile of the country, the economic activities, and the workforce available in that country. Certain economies, such as China, which have a lot of manufacturing-oriented jobs, might find those easier to automate away than a more service-oriented economy, such as the United States. On the other hand, there is Japan, which has quite a high-performing economy from a technological point of view, but older population with a diminishing workforce. So in order to sustain the economic growth, like their only rational decision might be to automate a lot of these positions to supply the lack of workers. Now that we've seen what is the general picture, I would like to change a little bit like the focus on a specific case study, namely autonomous vehicles. I believe this one could be very relevant nowadays because there are lots of money being invested into research, both academia and companies. And some optimistic estimates claim that in less than 5 years, we'll have fairly capable autonomous vehicles solutions. And it is also a good example of seeing how a certain change can have ripple effects in a lot of domains. Starting with the benefits, the most immediate one is the reduced accident rate. Studies claim that over 90% of the accidents are due to human error in the US, with over 1 million deaths per year. And all these people being saved would be able to contribute significantly to the well-being of the society afterwards. Also, you would be able to redirect like staff and resources from domains to other causes, such as like medical research and elderly care, which is going to be a huge challenge in the future with the growing old population. Climate benefits are also important to specify via reduced fuel usage and emissions. And if we take into account large fleets of autonomous vehicles cooperating coupled with electric vehicles technologies, this can be further improved. A game-changing benefit is the more inclusive access to transportation means for certain disadvantaged groups. We include in those like disabled people, elderly people, children, or families which were previously not able to maintain a car on a day-to-day basis. They will be able to gain mobility and lots of both economic and entertainment opportunities. And this means that a larger market will be open for auto car makers. Beyond this, we'll also probably see like an increased demand for software, online shopping and multimedia services because people in these cars would like to spend their time one way or another. High logistics potential for truck companies with more goods moved from one zone to another for a lower cost and gaining back lots of urban dead zones which were previously dedicated to cars. And obviously lots of new job positions made in order to develop the infrastructure needed to ensure properly functioning autonomous vehicles. Moving forward with the risks, the most immediate one is the widespread redundancy of driving jobs, with over 4 million vehicle operator jobs estimated to be lost in the US alone, which could affect over 20 million people if you take into account their family members, for instance. And their problem is that they have fewer transferable skills, lower educational levels, and lower wages, which makes it more difficult for them to find a new job. Another sector which is going to be hit is the insurance industry, which mostly deals with liability issues around accidents, and having a reduced number of accidents might mean the shrinkage of up to 60%, which is over $100 billion in the US alone. The same applies to the repair industry, maybe even more severely, because the few accidents which will take place will might have totally different causes and effects, like software bugs or expensive sensors going faulty and needing to be repaired. And most of the workers currently hired in repair shops do not have the skills necessary to handle these type of cases. So that the entire industry might vanish in case they do not change their business model. And the potential negative effect might be on the general lifestyle of the population. Might be more inclined to go and use autonomous vehicles to ride to different destinations instead of taking more healthier approaches. Here we have like a general overview of the stakeholders, starting with the automakers, some positively affected, some negatively affected depending on how disrupted they are. Then moving over to the auto drivers, some saving their lives, others losing their jobs. And then finally, the ripple effects in the society at large and numerous other economic sectors. Nonetheless, like these benefits will not come by themselves, and we must take action in order to ensure that they reach out to the maximum amount of people and also to mitigate the potential side effects. A first suggestion for improvement is to encourage mobility as a service approaches. One autonomous vehicle could replace up to 11 private vehicles. And in case you have multiple autonomous vehicles working together, we could go further and access traffic optimization via vehicle-to-vehicle and vehicle-to-infrastructure communication. Helping vulnerable workers is essential, and we must ensure extra funds to supply their job training and maybe help some retain their current positions, their current jobs, but with a slightly adjusted role. Also, large-scale education and information policies are needed because we are going to have a transition period, as we've seen, with a mix of human drivers and AVs on public roads. And legislation needs to clearly be able to deal with this type of cases, both liability in terms of accidents, privacy, and security of the users during transit. Also, it's going to be important to negotiate potential cultural differences between different driving styles among countries. Nonetheless, this is just a small part, but let's say a more realistic one, which is of the automation wave, which is going to hit us in the next 10 to 20 years. And I believe that in order to reach an optimal post-automation society, we need to focus on the goals of fairness, transparency, and sustainability, and make sure those are achieved while implementing all other technologies. The following are just like some rough guidelines, and each country will need to adapt those like to their social, demographic, economic, and financial makeup. But nonetheless, all it has to start with a major redesign of the educational system, focusing also on the retraining of mid-career workers and lifelong learning, possibly new ways of certifying skills, such that you wouldn't be needed to go back to university to grab a diploma for something you have learned on your job list. Everybody should be technologically literate because this is going to be as important as being able to read and write nowadays. And more emphasis should be put on soft skills and general cognitive skills, which are harder to automate away, and across activity skills, which can be used in multiple jobs of the future, which will require higher qualifications. Better information of the general public is needed in order to reduce like the general paranoia and potential social unrest, because we've seen in the history that these type of revolutions are usually associated with unemployment or also riots from the population. And it is essential to come up in advance with policies to aid in career transitions. For instance, governments or companies or workers could fund together an unemployment insurance for the workers. And once a worker goes out of job, They can access this type of funds to maintain their livelihood or either access retraining like in advance in order to prepare for potential changes in the workplace. Also, companies should be encouraged to retain their current workers because there's going to be a big shortage of qualified workforce in the future. Finally, updated labor legislation. With all the added productivity from automation tools, we might no longer be needed to go through the usual 40-hour long work week. Ultimately, the biggest challenge is to ensure that the maximum amount of people get to benefit from all these changes. On the left, we can see that the amount of income, which is redirected towards the workers from the companies, is decreasing among the economies. And on the right, we can see the effect of this. Like over 40% of the people are not able to save virtually anything from their income. And we have seen that these are the people which mostly need it. An immediate side effect of this is the fact that even if you are a big tech company with automated chains of production, there might be not enough customers on the market so that you can reap the rewards of the automation in which you've invested so much money. On the other hand, governments will need to find extra ways to ensure a steady stream of income because there will be fewer taxpayers and a lot of extra money will be needed in order to cover the much needed safety net for the workers. And this type of inequality is also seen at the company level because small and medium enterprises are not able to compete with the big players on the market. Even if recently Ford and Waymo released some data sets in order to accelerate the development of autonomous vehicle technologies, one could ask himself if that is enough. What if companies, for instance, would follow Volvo's example, which decided to release for free the patent for the safety belt in the 50s for the health of the population? Or what if governments or other policymakers would step in and say that certain features are mandatory across all types of cars, also for safety reasons? In the long term, however, I believe we should shift a little bit our stance and follow this guy's piece of advice, who is the most famous person who has been replaced by a robot, and try to worry more about the people and not the jobs. Because ultimately, the sole purpose of technology is to ensure that our lives are getting better and maybe we can benefit more leisure time instead of working. And it's up to us to decide like whether that happens or not in the future. So thank you very much. This is the end of my presentation and I'm ready for questions.